I'm Cody Kearns, and this is my wife, Sarah. We were married 3 years ago on July 30th, up at Camp Okoboji on West Lake, and it was 98 degrees outside.
I would say that we keep the spark in our marriage by trying to make sure that we make time to connect every day. Sometimes that can be hard with three children and very busy schedules, but one of the ways we do that is we keep a very strict bedtime schedule. Probably not even as much for the children as for us. And the kids go to bed at a decent time, fairly early, I guess you could say, and the house is quiet, and that gives us time. Sometimes it just means we just sit next to each other and don't say a word. Sometimes we can catch up on things that we don't really talk about with our kids, adult talk. Sometimes we do something fun together. And sometimes we just go to bed early, but it gives us time every single night that no matter how our day has gone, good, bad, or otherwise, we have that time to reconnect. And we always try to make sure that we go to bed at the same time together every night.
I think when we took the vows, we not only made a promise to each other, but we made a promise to God that through everything, through all the speed bumps, that we would stick it out because that's what God wants. And in the end, God will be our judge, and we, if we did what the vows said, for richer, for poorer, through sickness and health, till death parts us.
Being that we started our marriage in a little bit of a non-traditional way and created a blended family, it created a few obstacles and a few challenges, and there are times when I think both of us maybe tried to take it into our own hands, and we really had to come back together and pray about it and decide, okay, what would God want us to do in this situation? How would He want us to handle that? God influences our marriage on a daily basis, to be honest. We're not perfect people. None of us are. And I, by nature, am not a very patient person. He has that quality, definitely. And so we have to work daily to think of God's love toward His people and toward His church, and try, I mean, that's what it says in the Bible, that marriage should reflect. And so we really try to work on that, and at times when we're not being very godly toward each other or concerning things surrounding our marriage, we have to really try to look at what He would want us to do and how He would want us to handle it.
It's always fun to start a sermon with a little peek at my life, but of course we're in this series on marriage, so any story I tell you that ties into the topic is obviously going to involve Beth. So I thought it wise if I check with her first. This week's message is on fighting fair. We're going to talk about conflict in marriage. So I asked Beth if she had any examples of things we fight about that I could safely talk about in public. She gave me the green light for this one. So here's a thing we fight about. Ice cream. It's true. Beth and I fight about ice cream. Here's the deal. We like ice cream at our house. We like it in a bowl with some chocolate on top, a few peanuts, that sort of thing. I like to make an occasional peanut butter malt. Sometimes Beth will bake brownies and we'll throw some ice cream on top of that. We like ice cream. Mostly we like good old vanilla ice cream. So we usually keep a plastic bucket, a 1 gallon bucket of ice cream in the house. We have a deep freeze in the garage, so that's where we keep it. Now, of course, this big deep freeze, that means when we want ice cream, it's usually frozen pretty solid. Sometimes it's hard to scoop up. So when Beth gets ice cream, she likes to microwave it. It's a plastic bucket with a plastic handle. It's microwave safe, so she opens up the microwave, tosses it in, powers it up to high, runs it for 4 or 5 minutes. That's probably not true, but maybe a minute. I don't know how long she does this, but she puts it in the microwave first. That's my point. Then she takes it out. It's as easy to scoop as you could want. Clever solution to a vexing problem. I, however, have a problem with this, because my problem is when you put the bucket back in the freezer, the parts that were melty from the microwave refreeze, and they don't refreeze as ice cream. In fact, they freeze harder than it was before, so the next person who goes to scoop ice cream out of the bucket now has to work even harder. Beth says, throw it back in the microwave. Not a good solution. Even more annoying, when ice cream refreezes, it forms all sorts of ice crystals. Have you ever had this? So then now when you scoop your ice cream doesn't taste like ice cream. Now your ice cream's chunky. Ice cream shouldn't be chunky unless there are peanuts on it. So, to me, her microwave is a short-term solution that causes long-term problems. So we have conflict. Beth is a hospitable person who wants everyone to have easy access to large quantities of ice cream. I'm a hungry person who doesn't want my ice cream to have ice crystals in it. So I thought we'd put it to a vote. She's not here. So, yeah, I mean, next service, but however this service comes out, I'm just going to report it however I want. How many of you think microwaving ice cream so it's easier to scoop is a good idea? Okay, now, how many of you want your ice cream to taste like ice cream? Yeah, there we go. All right, good. I don't even have to lie to her about how that vote came out. All right. Here's the thing. If you are married, you will have conflict. It's inevitable. You can't avoid it. Mark Driscoll says, marriage is an unconditional commitment to an imperfect person. I think that's a decent definition. Marriage is an unconditional commitment to an imperfect person. Anytime you take one sinner and you add another sinner, the result is going to be conflict. It's going to happen. This side of heaven, anytime you put two sinful people together, eventually disagreements are going to happen. So if you're married, you will have conflict. The challenge is to deal with conflict in a God-honoring way. Conflict can kill a marriage, or conflict can make a marriage stronger. The difference hinges on how well you handle the conflict that inevitably comes your way. There's a graphic that I often use when I'm doing premarital counseling. It comes from a book that I really appreciate called The Peacemaker by Ken Sandy. And this graphic is called The Slippery Slope of Conflict, and it looks like this. And I like this graphic because it illustrates the dangers that lie on both sides of conflict. On the right-hand side, as you're looking at it, those are the attack responses. This is what we usually think of as the ugly side of conflict. This is why we don't like conflict. It involves raised voices, red faces, lost tempers. This is peace-breaking. And at the extreme, it involves assault, litigation, even murder. Obviously, this is not handling conflict well. As the whole Ray Rice incident has so vividly reminded us, physical confrontation is never a good way to resolve conflict. But there's a danger over on the other side as well. These are the responses of people who would rather escape conflict than deal with it. This is what we might call codependency. It's the passive acceptance of bad behavior out of fear of what confrontation might lead to. This is peace faking. And it's no more healthy than peace breaking. At the extreme, on this side, there's denial, there's flight, even suicide. And the goal is to be in the middle, to be a peacemaker. This is where conflict is met head on, but dealt with in constructive and loving ways. In the middle lie activities like forgiveness and discussion, loving confrontation, and reconciliation. And most of us are scared to end up over here on the right-hand side of the chart. We don't want to be peace breakers, so we spend a lot of our time over on the left-hand side of the chart. We become peace fakers. We don't have the hard conversations because we're not confident that we can do it well. But peacemaking should always be the goal. We've been using the Song of Songs as the biblical basis for this series. The song is primarily a book of romance. It's a celebration of the love between a man and a woman. So there's not a lot of conflict in the book, but it does touch on it. Take chapter 2, verse 15, for example. It says, "Catch for us the foxes, the little foxes that ruin the vineyards, our vineyards that are in bloom." Now, my daughter Ellie loves foxes. They're her favorite animal. We usually think of foxes as, you know, very attractive animals. But in this case, they're pests. They're rodents that have the potential for ruining the vineyard. And so the Bible says they must be caught. Catch them while they're little. And symbolically, what I think this means is that we should catch the conflicts in our relationship. Deal with them directly. Catch them while they're small and address them in a way that's God-honoring. So what I want to do in this message today is give you some coaching for conflict. I'd like to give you some suggestions for how to fight well. And while the context is a series on marriage, This is a topic that applies to everybody, all kinds of different relationships. Whether we're talking about how you relate to your coworkers or your roommates or your siblings or your parents or other people right here at church, we can all use some help in fighting fair. And since the Song of Songs doesn't say much about conflict other than this verse that I have up there now, we'll have to look elsewhere in the Bible to get our coaching. So I'm going to share with you a story of a married couple in the Bible that did not handle conflict well. We're going to look at the story of David and Michael from 2 Samuel 6 to learn what not to do in conflict. And then I'm also going to take you to the New Testament, to Ephesians chapter 4, for some commentary on what we should do when we're having conflict. This is an outline that I'm borrowing from Pastor Dave Stone, who's co-pastor with Kyle Eidelman of Southeast Christian Church in Louisville. So let me tell you about David and Michael. David, of course, is the slayer of Goliath, who went on to become the most famous king in Israel's history. Michael is his first wife, and she's the daughter of King Saul, who preceded David on the throne. Now, it's important to know as I get into this story that Michael and David started out in love. It was almost a fairy tale. In fact, Saul promised he would give his oldest daughter to David if David went and fought against the Philistines. And Saul was thinking, if David fights against the Philistines often enough, eventually he'll die and Saul won't have to deal with him anymore. But that didn't happen. And so when David comes back to marry the oldest daughter of Saul, Saul actually double-crosses him and gives his oldest daughter to someone else to be married. But through it all, there's Michael, who's the younger daughter of Saul, and she's in love with David. So David goes out, he kills 200 Philistines as sort of his bride price and comes back to win Michael's hand. And they start out in love. A little later, when Saul decides that he needs David killed, he sends a group of assassins, a group of thugs after him. It's Michael who gets word of the plot, helps David to escape through a window, sticks a statue in David's bed, goes and confronts the assassins and says, "No, David's too sick to come out to be killed right now." So David and Michael started out in love. But over the ensuing years, as David is running in the wilderness, trying to hide from her father, she's separated from him. They grow apart. In fact, eventually Saul takes Michael and gives her in marriage to a different man as a sort of way of getting at David. So finally, when Saul dies and David becomes king, one of the very first things he does is he demands that Michael be returned to him. And you can imagine, at this point, the relationship was a bit strained. And the incident I want to talk about takes place shortly after this, as David is taking the Ark of the Covenant into Jerusalem. Now, the Ark of the Covenant, Indiana Jones, the Ark of the Covenant was the place where the tablets containing the Ten Commandments were kept. It was this very important holy relic. In fact, it was said that God's presence resided with the Ark. And so David decides, he has claimed Jerusalem as his capital city, and he thinks it's going to be important to bring the ark into Jerusalem. And so he does that, and the first attempt at bringing the ark into Jerusalem doesn't go well. They don't follow the instructions for moving the ark. They put it on an ox cart. It sort of wobbles. A guy named Uzzah sticks out his hand to keep it from falling. God is angry at Uzzah. Uzzah dies. It didn't go well. But the second time that David attempts to bring the ark into Jerusalem, they do things right. And they throw this sort of parade, and they carry the ark into the city. And David goes before the ark, celebrating, offering sacrifices. This is a big moment for him, because this is the moment where God's presence is coming into his city that sort of confirms that David is God's choice to be king over Israel. This is sort of the consolidation of all of his power. So David is worshiping before God as he leads this ark in this nationwide parade. And here's what happens. 2 Samuel 6, verses 14 and 15. It says, "David, wearing a linen ephod, danced before the Lord with all his might. And while he and the entire house of Israel brought up the ark of the Lord with shouts and the sound of trumpets." It's a big moment. So David's really celebrating. He strips down to just his underclothes, basically a t-shirt and some underpants. That's what a linen ephod is. And he dances. He's worshiping. It's a historic day. But Michael, his wife, is not impressed. Verse 16. As the ark of the Lord was entering the city of David, Michal, daughter of Saul, watched from a window. And when she saw King David leaping and dancing before the Lord, she despised him in her heart. Now, there are a couple of ways to read this story. One is through the eyes of worship. David is so sold out for God. He's so excited that the presence of God is coming into his capital city that he simply does not care what he looks like. He's going to worship with all of his heart. He doesn't care what anybody else thinks of him. That's, in fact, that's the argument he's going to use here in just a moment. But the other way to read this story is through the eyes of a wife. She looks out the window, and all she sees is her husband, dressed in his boxer shorts, dancing in front of all of the women of Jerusalem. She doesn't see worship, she sees lewdness. And I can't blame Michal for being upset. Any spouse has a right to feel wronged if their mate is acting single. Because basically that's what it looks like to her. Apparently David has crossed the line. Either he's done so intentionally or unintentionally, but he is displaying more than he should have. And so this is the basis of their conflict. Here's where we're going to get our coaching. And the first thing we can learn is this. Deal with conflict quickly, but kindly. Catch the little foxes quick, but be nice about it. Here's what happens when David gets home. Verse 20. When David returned home to bless his household, Michal, daughter of Saul, came out to meet him and said, "How the king of Israel has distinguished himself today, disrobing in the sight of the slave girls of his servants as any vulgar fellow would." Michal gets part of this right. She doesn't let it fester. She doesn't wait hours or days or weeks to stew over what happened. She saw something she didn't like, and she calls David on it. But she isn't nice. Her greeting is dripping with sarcasm. There's bitterness all over what she's saying. "Oh, how the king has distinguished himself today." In other words, man, you aren't much of a king. You embarrassed yourself out there. You embarrassed me. You acted like a commoner, like any vulgar fellow would. Michal is full attack mode. She wants to hurt him. She wants to wound him. And so often, especially in marital conflict, it seems like we want to hurt the other person. We aren't kind. We aren't gentle. Something happens that we don't like. We assume that we know exactly what the other person is thinking and why they did what they did, and so we attack. If only we could learn to be nice. If only we can learn to approach conflict gently and with humility. Imagine if Michal had said something like, "Wow, you brought the ark home. What an amazing moment for you. What a victory. I understand why you're celebrating. But David, there was something I saw when I looked out the window that I wasn't really comfortable with. And I'm wondering, could I talk with you about it?" Would the conversation have gone better if she'd said something like that? I'd like to think it would have. Here's what the Apostle Paul says in Ephesians 4, which we can read as a sort of coaching manual on how to handle conflict well. He writes, "In your anger, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down while you are still angry, and do not give the devil a foothold." In your anger, do not sin. Not don't get angry. The Bible recognizes that there are times and occasions when it is right to be angry. Certain situations are wrong, they need to be addressed. Jesus got angry on several occasions. But in your anger, do not sin. Just because you're upset, that's not an excuse for cutting sarcasm or hostile words. Just because you're mad doesn't give you the right to start tearing people down. Just because you're angry doesn't make it okay to fly into a rage. And notice the other part of this verse. Do not let the sun go down while you're still angry. In other words, deal with conflict quickly. Address it up front. Don't let it sit and stew. Another way to read this is don't go to bed mad. 20 years of marriage, Beth and I have tried to live by this principle. We get things settled by bedtime. It's worked pretty well. There was that one time when we didn't sleep for 3 weeks, but, you know. that's not exactly. I don't think that's exact. It doesn't mean you have to have everything settled before you're allowed to sleep. Really, I think what Paul is saying is that you need to at least approach it. You at least need to begin working on it. Sometimes a good night's sleep brings a whole different perspective. But Paul's saying, yeah, at least have to start the process. Address conflict quickly. And if you do need to go to bed, at least say something like this. You know, I know this issue isn't settled, but I'm committed to work through it with you. I know we disagree. Even though we do disagree, it doesn't mean I don't love you anymore. Let's get some rest, and I promise you we'll find a way to figure this out. A statement like that can go a long way toward easing the tension, opening a way to reconciliation. But here's the thing. If you say something like that, then you need to follow through. You can't just hope it goes away the next day. You have to pick it up again. You have to make sure it's settled. So here's the next bit of coaching. Deal with conflict thoroughly, but not vindictively. Work through the issue, but make sure you keep it about the issue. Let's go back to the story of Michael and David now. So Michael attacks David over what she saw through the window. And here's how David responds, verse 21. David said to Michael, "It was before the Lord who chose me rather than your father or anyone else from his house when he appointed me ruler over the Lord's people Israel. I will celebrate before the Lord." David takes a shot at her dad. Just remember, he seems to be saying, God chose me, not Pops. That seems like an unnecessary jab. Then verse 22. "And I will become even more undignified than this, and I will be humiliated in my own eyes, but by these slave girls you speak of, I will be held in honor." In other words, the other girls didn't seem to mind. Ooh, David. You can't say that. Guys, don't say that. Do not bring other people into the argument, especially people of the other gender. You can't say, well, she thought it was funny, or, he doesn't seem to mind when I dress this way. Don't do that. That is never a healthy part of conflict. Remember, we're looking at this story, David and Michael, as an example of what not to do. This is a bad way to have conflict. David's argument here is that he's simply celebrating before the Lord, that the only audience he cares about is this audience of one, and he's willing to get even more undignified to show his love for God. And if that was his argument, and if he had stuck to that issue, it's not a bad argument. If he had stuck to it. But that's not what he does. He sticks in the knife about her father. Then he twists it around a little bit by talking about these other women. They're not fighting over the issue anymore. They're just throwing insults at each other. I can't say this emphatically enough. When you have a conflict, keep it about the issue. If you're discussing ice cream in the microwave, don't turn it into a fight about how lazy or gluttonous the other person is. If you're having a discussion about money, don't turn it into a fight about how selfish or careless the other person is. Stick to the matter at hand. Here's what Paul says in Ephesians 4, verses 29 and 31. "Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs, that it may benefit those who listen. Get rid of all bitterness, rage, and anger, brawling, and slander, along with every form of malice." You have to be careful about the words you use. You need to ask yourself, am I about to say this because I care about this other person? I want our relationship to work. Or am I going to say this because I just want to win this argument, and I wouldn't mind hurting that other person in the process? There's such a temptation when you're in a conflict to do whatever it takes to win the argument. I mean, I struggle with this all the time. I like to be right. I'm competitive. I don't like to lose. But here's something I've got to learn, and you do too. Marriage is not about winning or losing. Chip Ingram once said, "Marriage is not a debate to be won, it's a dance to be enjoyed." Instead of seeing every conflict as a contest which you must win, how about approaching it with the intent of understanding and loving your spouse better? Get rid of the ugly, bitter words. Choose instead words that build up. Choose helpful words. And above all, stick to the issue. So now the third piece of coaching. Deal with conflict honestly, but forgive. Here's the hardest part. You have to be honest about what's going on with you. You have to be willing and able to forgive. Here's the last verse in the story. This is the last biblical word on Michal. So sad. And Michal, daughter of Saul, had no children to the day of her death. That's so sad. I mean, you can read this is like God's judgment on Michal, but I think what it actually means is that this fight was so bad that David and Michal never came together as husband and wife again. And she remained childless till she died. You get the sense that their marriage never really recovered from this. And if only they could have dealt with this conflict honestly and with forgiveness. If only Michal could have said, you know, I'm so happy you were able to get the ark home, but it really bothered me that you were dancing half naked on the street. And then David could have said, oh, baby, I'm sorry about that. I got so carried away worshiping God out there that I forgot what I was doing. And she would have said, yeah, but all those girls were looking at you. And he would have said, I know, honey bun. That's my fault, but you're the only girl I want to see me looking like that. And she said, are you sure? And he would have said, "Honey, baby, I've never been more sure of anything in my life. If their conversation had gone something like that, you know, nicknames and all, then maybe things could have turned out differently for them. They could have forgiven each other. Their marriage would have been stronger for it, but they didn't. And their marriage died in a desert of bitterness and neglect. Listen to me. Marriage can survive with conflict. It can. In fact, it has to. Marriage can survive with conflict. This is where we started, right? One sinner plus one sinner equals conflict. So your marriage has to, if your marriage is going to survive, if your marriage is going to thrive, it has to be able to work through conflict. It can survive with conflict, but here, marriage cannot survive without forgiveness. You have to be able to work through the conflict and forgive. Back to Ephesians, verse 32. Paul says, be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Jesus Christ God forgave you. There's a scary word in this verse, a real scary word. And the word is that two-letter word, as. The standard of forgiveness that we are asked to live up to, the model that we're supposed to emulate, is Christ's forgiveness of you. I mean, think about that. Your marriage, the things that you fight about, and it feels like I cannot forgive that, or any other relationship you're in, and it's like it hurts so bad, I don't know how I can ever forgive that. Just remember what Jesus has already done for you. Remember, there's a day coming. There's a day coming for every single one of us, whether you're married or divorced or single or widowed or whatever. There's a day coming when we are all going to stand in front of the throne of God. And the only hope any of us have that we're going to be accepted at that moment is whether or not we know the forgiveness of Jesus Christ. The only hope any of us have of entering into God's presence is that we have accepted what Jesus has done when he took on this catastrophic conflict of the cross. For every sin, for every impurity, for every wicked thing that you've ever done, Jesus took that to the cross in order to forgive you. And now he's saying, can you, in your relationships, can you learn to forgive in some fashion the same way that I've already forgiven you? That's the standard of forgiveness that has been shown to us, that's been modeled for us. Are we willing to give that kind of forgiveness to one another? Let me wrap this up by taking us back to the Song of Songs. Chapter 2, verse 16. This is actually the verse that comes right after the verse about the foxes. It says this. It says, my lover is mine, and I am his. He browses among the lilies. The same verse gets repeated in chapter 6, verse 3, only gets reversed. I am my lover's and my lover is mine. It even repeats the part about browsing in the lilies, and I do not know what that means. But the first part, the first line in that verse is obvious enough. These two belong to each other. They're on the same team. Their relationship with one another is far more important than being on the right side of any silly argument. And if you are married, I want you to remember this. You are your lover's, and your lover is yours. You belong to each other. You're on the same side. Your spouse is not your enemy. And one more thing. Some of you are in marriages where you just don't know how to deal with the conflict anymore. The little foxes have become giant wolves, right? And they're howling at the door. There's been so much hurt, so many harsh words, that there's just so little forgiveness left. And either your home is a constant hurricane of peace breaking, or you're just leading two separate lives and you've gotten really good at the peace faking. Well, if that's you, let me ask you to please talk to somebody. Please tell somebody about it. I know that's not how we do things around here. I mean, I know, you know, you don't ever let anybody see behind the veneer that we put on for public appearances and that sort of thing. We don't really want anybody to see us vulnerable or weak or know that we can't feel like we can't handle it on our own. But if the conflict in your marriage has gotten so bad that you don't know how to fix it, please talk to somebody. Talk to me. Talk to Jay. Find another couple in church that can be kind of like marriage mentors to you. Go to a good Christian counselor. Because whatever it's going to cost you in embarrassment and swallowed pride to admit that there are problems, just remember, it's going to cost you a whole lot more in pain and hurt to see your marriage swallowed up in bitterness and neglect. You are your beloved's. And your beloved is yours. That's worth fighting for. Let's pray. Jesus, again, I just want to pray for marriages, the marriages represented here today. Your word talks about this. It gives us examples, good and bad, of how to work through conflict. Lord, help us to, especially in our marriages, help Ephesians 4, help those words of wisdom there be mantras that we repeat over and over again. Help us to be angry without sinning. Help us to use words that build up, not tear down. Lord, help us to forgive. Lord, I lift up each marriage here and ask you, Lord, that you would bless each one today with clear communication. Help us to have the serious talks that we have to have, the ones we've been putting off. Help us to reaffirm our love for one another, to remember what it is that drew us to each other in the first place. And above all, Lord, help us to live around that throne of grace. In the grace, Lord, that you made available to us at the cross. So that, Lord, we can see our way fit to continue to love even through the difficult times. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. God's not dead, he's surely alive. He's living on the inside, roaring like a lion. God's not dead, he's surely alive. Let hope arise and make the darkness hide. My faith is dead.